This is Special Agent Sean Keyes, Regional Director of the Otherworldly Lifeform Task Force. The date is February 23rd, 1996. After accepting this position, the team felt it would be a good idea to start recording my general thoughts for posterity. So, few people have been exposed to the kind of things I'll be seeing, and to be honest, I'm not sure if that's exciting or terrifying. Regardless, now that I've been fully debriefed, I can get to work investigating this fascinating species. Director Peter Keyes, my father, was part of the OWLF in 1987 when first contact was made with the Predator by a team of highly trained Special Forces soldiers in South America. And the Predator was disabled by the last surviving member of the team, triggering a powerful self-destruct mechanism. My father and his team interviewed the survivor extensively while an OWLF survey team combed the blast area for any evidence. Besides some additional information on the species from the survivor, the team found very little to recover. It's been nearly 10 years since first contact, but I hold out hope that this is a sign of things to come. December 3rd, 1996. Things have been moving slowly. I knew this would be difficult, but there's finding a needle in a haystack, and then there's finding a needle in 20 haystacks. I've spent most of my time sifting through hundreds of documents and countless data entries trying to understand the Predators, a name my father apparently gave them. After the OWLF made contact with the survivor of the Valverde encounter, Alan Schaefer, they received a wealth of knowledge that helped define how these creatures operate, luring and stalking prey, skinning them, making trophies of their bones. I mean, these are the hallmarks of a sport hunter, not a simple carnivore. And furthermore, when Schaefer was completely disarmed, the Predator removed its own weapons, suggesting a cultural system of honor. And after the first encounter, things started to fall in place. Some details and past stories yielded more data in retrospect. And these notes, looks like we've had multiple documented encounters over the past few years, but nothing that yielded more than stories and other anecdotal evidence. February 12th, 1997. The team here has spent the last few years working on countermeasures and other methods for hunting the hunters. If we can get the jump on one of these bastards and catch it alive, the world would change forever. It's strange that nothing has ever been recovered from a Predator encounter. No body, limb, even a finger has ever been found, although this isn't entirely surprising. The Predator is perfectly designed for covert hunting. I mean, we can't see it because it employs advanced light-bending technology that renders it effectively invisible. However, it can see us perfectly through active infrared scanning, and we're betrayed by our own natural body heat. Fortunately, the infrared isn't too advanced. Dutch Schaefer was able to evade the Predator's sight by covering himself in cool mud. So this led the team to develop a bodysuit that similarly masks the wearer's infrared signature. And we're still working on ways to counteract the cloaking system, but recent efforts have been encouraging. July 2nd, 1997. It's happening. We've gotten word that a crime scene in Los Angeles reportedly contains hanged, scanned bodies. LA's also experiencing a record heat wave, which correlates to data suggesting that ambient heat is a factor when predators choose their hunting grounds. Now, I'm convinced that we're experiencing a new encounter. The field team boarded a plane hours ago and should be on site before the end of the day. To maintain secrecy, my father and the OWLF agents are going undercover as DEA agents investigating drug trafficking in Los Angeles. Our intent is to capture the city hunter alive. Now, with this goal in mind, we've outfitted the team with infrared suits, nitrogen-based freezing mechanisms, and a broad surveillance package to monitor as much of the city as we can. I shouldn't get my hopes up, but this still could be some kind of, you know, run-of-the-mill homicidal maniac, but I wouldn't put money on it. Until our team receives confirmation, we're holding back to prep the lab for receiving. The next few days should be interesting. July 8th, 1997. I just received positive confirmation from the LA team. There is an active predator and its hunting ground is downtown Los Angeles. I still haven't fully processed that this is actually happening, but I need to, and fast. The surveillance team has been tracking its movements, developing a consistent pattern for how the alien hunts. The rest of the team has set a trap at a slaughterhouse in the warehouse district where the predator's been feeding. A helpful bit of information that confirms the hunting is solely for sport and not nutrition. The plan is to deploy countermeasures, then covertly assault a predator using the heat-dampening suits. It's a risky gambit, but with such a limited timetable, we have to take opportunity when we can. I think it's the best thing we just head to L.A. and establish a mobile lab so we can be ready the second predator's captured. If this goes to plan, we'll be involved in one of the most momentous moments in human history. July 10th, 1997. It's been several days since the L.A. encounter. The director of the OWLF, Peter Jacob Keyes, my father, was killed in the line of duty attempting to capture a predator codenamed City Hunter. I was in Los Angeles that night, prepping the mobile lab for capture, only to receive a panicked message from a survivor of the raid. The City Hunter was more prepared than we had thought. Managed to kill most of the team inside the slaughterhouse, including my father. It's a dark day for the OWLF. We failed to give mankind proof we're not alone in the universe while simultaneously letting a threat to our species slip through our grasp. But we have to move forward. While we did fail to capture the City Hunter, we collected an impressive amount of data on it. Most significantly, an account from Detective Lieutenant Michael Harrigan, who supposedly killed the City Hunter with one of its own weapons. In his statement, he reported that shortly after the City Hunter expired, a host of older aliens appeared. And they spared Harrington, allowing him to leave. Taking the City Hunter's body with them, they launched their spaceship into the night sky. We retraced Harrigan's steps based on his testimony. And while battling the City Hunter must have had its share of collateral damage, there was little evidence that could be differentiated from the normal gang violence found in Los Angeles. However, in a rather nondescript alley, we did find something that, while not worth the price that we paid, will pave the way to making our sacrifices not in vain. It was blood. The undeniably extraterrestrial, bioluminescent, green blood of the predator. And this, in and of itself, was a remarkable find. But at the end of the blood trail was the City Hunter's arm. I immediately ordered for the alley to be quarantined should someone wander onto the find, but I was too late. Somebody was already there. I tried to warn the stranger off with our cover story, but He just laughed from inside the shadows. I reached for my sidearm, but then the stranger lit a cigar. And in the sudden bloom of light, I recognized the face of Major Alan Dutch Schaefer. He was older, and he was thinner than the photos we'd had of him, but it was him. OWLF agents swarmed into the alley, but Dutch didn't resist. Did he mean to get caught, or did his curiosity get the better of him? It's hard to say. The last known whereabouts of Major Schaefer were in OWLF custody shortly after having been interviewed by my father, then Special Agent Peter Keyes, shortly after the Valverde incident. The last time I heard of Dutch was when he vanished from OWLF custody after my father had questioned him concerning the events in Valverde. But here he was, in the same place as another predator attack. In the debriefing, he tells me everything, how he was good friends with my father, and how he'd been unofficially let go to help hunt down and find these creatures. They've secretly been keeping tabs with each other over the last few years, sharing discoveries and leads to different predator encounters in the attempts to stop this threat. After seeing the signs, he too showed up in LA to help track down the city hunter, but limited resources kept him from getting here in time to do anything. July 11th, 1997, Dutch has been surprisingly helpful to our efforts. He knew my father, and he was sympathetic about his death. He offered to help us in exchange for funding and a team. Dutch would be our on-site agent for any alien incursion. And when he says he knows them and how they hunt, I believe him. If Dutch could start bringing back bodies, technology, even just first-hand accounts, we could make huge advancements. But before he left, Dutch brought out what I'd seen briefly in the alley. It was a collapsible spear, the same one the city hunter used against Harrington. He wanted to keep it as a down payment. While advanced, the spear was relatively rudimentary. I was reluctant to let it go, but it seemed like a good faith investment, though I doubt I could have stopped him anyway. The good news is that Dutch gave us a fully functioning alien helmet, easily the better part of the bargain, besides the wealth of knowledge that the helmet and arm would bring us alone would change the course of history. My father's passing has, it's been difficult. But everything was finally coming together. It seems now that both Dutch and I are in this together. I don't know. It makes for a strange kind of closure, I guess. September 21st, 1997. My father's associate and close friend, Agent Adam Garber, has been chosen to head up OWLF operations, and he's chosen me to help him directly with research and operational efforts. We managed to secure a massive extension to our funding after we presented the helmet and severed predator arm. And after discussing it with Garber, I convinced him to keep Dutch and his crew off the record as much as possible, so Dutch can do so much more working alongside us than he ever could working for us officially. Appropriated funds for Dutch and his team have been marked as cleaning services. Studying the arm has revealed so much about the predator physiology, and we are just now scratching the surface of what this helmet can do. There's also a damaged computer attached to the wrist, which must have been destroyed by whatever severed the arm. It'll be a slow process, deconstructing, analyzing, reverse engineering the alien technology, but every discovery will be monumental as we learn more and more from a species so much more advanced than our own. December 1st, 1997. We ran extensive genetic tests on the arm, the results of which could lead to huge medical breakthroughs. It also gave us clues to the atmospheric makeup of their homeworld and how viable it would be to sustain human life, should we ever find a way to get there. And judging by the elasticity of the skin, we think that the City Hunter was a juvenile of the species. And this would line up with Detective Harrigan's account of the L.A. encounter. And with that in mind, one could theorize that its hunt may have been an initiation into adulthood. Carbon dating of the bone structure puts the City Hunter's age at a minimum of 300 years, which draws into question the lifespan of a predator. If our assumptions are correct, we could be talking upwards of 1,000 years, possibly more. I mean, the mask is like a mundane utilitarian item to the predator, but the technology involved is staggering. Aside from the respiratory functions, the visor built into the mask is capable of displaying multiple visual frequencies. I mean, this explains how the City Hunter found and killed the OWLF team in the slaughterhouse. I mean, we assumed that they only had access to infrared, but we were clearly wrong. What still confuses me, though, is how, with such extraordinary technology, the predators express a seemingly tribal culture. They have such a strong focus on honor, trophies, worthy opponents. I mean, things we've left behind as our own species has developed. I mean, is it possible that these technological advances were not developed by the predator species, but taken from another? March 12th, 1998. We've had our first strong lead since the LA encounter. At 2 a.m., a special forces group in Cambodia went MIA. The OWLF was alerted about the missing soldiers when skinned bodies was flagged in an update to military intelligence. We dispatched Dutch and his crew to the location within hours. Our research suggests that predator hunting grounds are active for roughly a week, and then we assume they return to their home world. But what's worrying is that our rate of detection seems to be escalating. I mean, either we're finding more predators or they're sending more. And this is exciting, but it's also worrying. If the number of predator events is increasing, we will inevitably cross a threshold where there are too many to handle. Dutch's team is highly effective at dealing with the menace as it is now, but unless we develop an advantage, humanity isn't prepared to face predator invasion. March 19th, 1999. Dutch's team managed to secure an intact piece of the predator weaponry. They tracked and killed the predator while somehow snagging its shoulder cannon before a group of elders showed up for the body exactly as it happened in L.A. The elders either didn't know or didn't care that Dutch stole the gun, but goddamn, I'm glad we managed to keep it. I have the team running preliminary tests on composition and rudimentary functionality, and I'd like to get those nailed down before anyone thinks about attempting to fire it. And based on how Dutch describes it, there was a preternatural connection between the weapon and the predator itself, which would imply advanced biometric controls. Alternatively, there could be a more direct connection with the mask. I don't know. I mean, there's so many possibilities, but only time and rigorous testing will tell. What's of paramount importance is that we don't blow ourselves up along the way. It's April 4th, 2001, and while I've had basic training, I usually stay away from field duty. However, it seemed prudent to have first-hand knowledge of the predators. And as Dutch continues to prove himself as an expert tracker, I was guaranteed a sighting if I went on the next mission. I opted out of arming myself, as previous accounts describe predators sparing the unarmed. I guess killing the defenseless must be seen as dishonorable. After infiltration, we quickly walked into a guerrilla ambush. And at this particular moment, I regretted my decision to go unarmed, but I kept my head down while Dutch and his team did their work. And after the dust settled, we heard a deafening roar. And in the clearing stood a massive predator. It had no mask. It was staring Dutch down in complete silence. After what seemed like minutes, it let out another roar, and it charged us. And as it was closing in, the predator threw a knife that missed Dutch, but it grazed my arm. And unfazed, Dutch grabbed a spear from his back, and he thrust it into the predator's chest. But the spear must have missed any vital organs, as the predator continued to fight Dutch before escaping into the jungle. And minutes later, we felt the ground rumble as a spacecraft lifted into the air and then left the planet entirely. And while I paid for it in physical trauma, I'm glad to have seen it in person. I can't say I'm disappointed to see what I saw. October 27th, 2004. We have officially secured a predator's body. Granted, it's pretty shot up, but it'll give us a wealth of information on their biology. I considered asking Dutch's team to look into less damaging methods of subduing the predator, but yeah, still Dutch and his team somehow achieved body exfiltration before it was intercepted or destroyed. So, while examinations of the body are ongoing, we're running parallel tests on the plasma caster weapon. No attempts at firing it have been made, as we are still trying to figure it out and whether or not it's functional. My hope is we can obtain more of these weapons for comparison, which would hopefully lead to replicating the technology. I mean, having the weapon of our enemy would dramatically increase our odds in an all-out conflict. July 8th, 2007. Today's the 10th anniversary of my father's death in Los Angeles. Because of his contributions to the OWLF, the very building I'm sitting in was named in his honor. Nothing stood in the way of his drive, his passion, and his desire to learn the secrets of the universe. With everything we've accomplished since his death, I'd like to think he'd be proud. And the best way to honor him now is to make sure his legacy lives on. Our team will continue to make history in the name of Peter Keyes. March 10th, 2008. The team is pretty shaken. On our last mission, Dutch's crew was killed. We dispatched his team to a hunting ground near a small village, but the entire village was empty. Investigating the scene revealed a fresh human skull and spine impaled and dangling on a predator spear at the center of the village. And that's when all hell broke loose. The team could find no target, as one by one, they were picked off. Dutch got the survivors into cover and offered himself up as a challenge as he drew his own spear. And within seconds, he stood face to face with a very unique predator. He described its armor as far more ornate, almost Egyptian in its regal design. Physically, it was slimmer, yet far more deadly than any previously encountered predator. Based on his description, I'm confident that what he encountered was the female of the species. I mean, our assumption has been that all known predators have been male, though up until now it was mostly an informed guess. Dutch was ambushed. He was pinned to a wall by the female's net launcher. And he observed the predator walk toward him and then activate her shoulder cannon, which quickly shot every member of his team with astonishing precision. And as the razor netting cut into his face, blood apparently ran into his eyes, and Dutch says he only barely saw the predator cloak and disappear into the jungle. Given the heavy casualties, Dutch's severe injuries, it's unlikely we'll be sending teams out for some time. I fear we've kicked the hornet's nest on this one, and well, now the queen is pissed. November 17th, 2008. For some time now, the medical team has been experimenting with technology devised from the Predator medical kit. Clearly predicting injury on their hunts, predators carry a small host of advanced medical devices. Now, while configured for predator physiology, the foundational technology is surprisingly universal, though nowhere near ready for human testing until March of this year. Dutch returned from a hunting ground with severe injuries after a confrontation with the predator female. The consensus was that he wouldn't survive, but with Dutch's consent, we used a host of experimental options to stabilize his condition, including a serum containing predator blood cells augmented with human DNA. One of the factors that contributes to the predator's long lifespan is their ability to regenerate tissue. And our hope is that this could be altered to identify human tissue as its own and repair it accordingly. So far, the serum has accelerated expected convalescence. What a man of Dutch's age should be able to heal in a year occurred in under 3 months. He will remain in quarantine and the side effects of the serum can be identified. Given how severe his injuries were, it's a small price to pay, though at some point we'll need to discuss sterilization with Major Schaefer. Because if this affects his DNA, we can't risk that change disseminating into the gene pool. It's May 24th, 2010, and things have been alarmingly calm, which is making me nervous. A short time after Dutch's brush with death, we had an energy surge that only affected the predator equipment. We have no idea what caused the surge and can't tell if it damaged anything, but it was definitely some sort of localized anomaly. Granted, we've collected quite the assortment of predator tech, but the possibility of losing even a few pieces is terrifying. I'm worried that this has something to do with the emergence of the predator female. Are they preparing for something? I doubt they've decided to leave Earth alone. Either way, we're in a holding pattern until the next encounter, but with this predator drought, we may be out of luck. March 3rd, 2015. With predator encounters dwindling, our funding has been adjusted accordingly. I know the other intelligence branches have been eager to get our section closed, as they're not privy to what exactly we've been doing. And they know we're in research and development, but we haven't produced any weaponry or technology that's ready for deployment, which was a major incentive for getting the OWLF established. As far as they know, we're just a bunch of UFO lunatics chasing conspiracy theories. The technology that we've recovered would suffice, but there's so much more to what we do than just harvesting weapons for conventional warfare. Regardless, I mean, it seems we'll have to bite the bullet and do what we need to do to defend humanity against the predator threat. If we throw the government some of our lesser breakthroughs, maybe that will keep the wolf from the door. Either way, we'll need a live specimen to make further significant strides. It seems that every encounter with Dutch leads to a dead predator and broken gear, and that's only if another band of predators doesn't show up and take the body. Long story short, something needs to start happening soon, or the OWLF may have to shutter. Final entry, August 29th, 2016. It's official, they're abolishing the OWLF. In my opinion, it was a certain central agency that stuck the final knife in our back. But that's not relevant anymore. A group of private contractors pitched a task force to replace us, and it was approved. Because we blazed a trail of discovery, they were able to swoop in and overpromise without putting in any of the legwork. Because of their prior weapon development experience and the guarantee of a predator within 1 year, they were swiftly greenlit. Many of our other agents, myself included, were given jobs on this new Project Stargazer. Since this is no longer the OWLF, I suppose I don't need to record these anymore. It's not like anyone will hear them. Research department's being cataloged and classified for storage. Still, I just wanted to say, I'm sorry, Dad. I'm sorry, Dad. I tried to keep it going. I really did. I tried to find a way to keep this from happening to anyone else. But it was too much. Now, Project Stargazer is not what you built. But I will make sure I bring your vision with me. Fortunately, Dutch managed to stay out of our official works, but I'm sure I'll be hearing from him soon.